giant voice.
The official podcast of the U.S. Navy's largest overseas installation, Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka. This is the Giant Voice Podcast.
So, hi, everybody. Welcome to the Giant Voice Podcast. We're here today with the Girl Scouts. So, we have had the Boy Scouts on, and it's only fair that we also have the Girl Scouts on. So, I'm super excited. I don't know very much about the Girl Scouts or scouting in general, so I'm excited to learn something today. It's also kind of a special occasion. They reached out to us. Because one of the people we are interviewing on the show today, she's going for something called a Gold Award, which we're going to ask her all about. And being on this podcast is actually going to fulfill one of the requirements for the award. So I think that's really actually pretty cool. Her name is Amanda Mayo. She is here. Amanda, nice to see you.
Nice to meet you too.
Awesome. And with her is her troop leader, Vicky Adams.
Hi.
Hi, Vicky. And actually, we were just talking. Vicky was on the show last year as part of the Red Cross, which is very cool to have her back. So why don't you give me the elevator pitch rundown about the Girl Scouts?
Sure. Well, we are part of Girl Scouts Overseas, which is a council that is part of the American Girl Scouts, but it serves all of the American girls living abroad. So girls on military bases or if they're in an expat community. And so the whole point of our Girl Scout programming is to help build girls of courage, confidence, and character. So they're learning leadership skills while doing fun activities. And the program goes all the way from kindergarten up through 12th grade. And then you can become an adult and a volunteer, a leader. There's a lot of ways to get involved after you graduate from high school. And Amanda is one of our ambassador Girl Scouts. That's the oldest Girl Scout that you can be. So girls in 11th and 12th grade cool. are ambassadors.
Cool. So how long have you been doing it for? When did you get started?
I've been doing Girl Scouts since I was like maybe 5.
Wow. That's really cool. So most of your life then, huh?
Yes.
Awesome. So what got you into it in the first place? Was it something that your parents had did or was it something you wanted to do? How did it start?
So it started when my mom put me in Girl Scouts and I kind of just followed through, to be honest. And I was like really nervous because I didn't know anyone. And this is like a way for my mom to like get me to be more social.
That's great. And did it work? Do you feel like it helped make you more social?
Yeah.
That's awesome. Perfect. I think that's part of the Girl Scouts kind of mission, right? Is to sort of foster that sense of community.
Yeah, absolutely. And especially for Girl Scouts overseas, it's so important because so many girls are moving around all the time.
Right.
And so it helps them have continuity in terms of programming, a great way to meet girls when they're, you know, maybe they've moved, you know, over fifth grade to sixth grade, they're moving to a completely new country.
Yep.
And so they're doing the same programming that they would have been doing with the girls who never left the United States. And as someone who has been abroad as an adult, it's the same for adults. So
sure.
It's always a place for me to go where I can meet leaders who want to do the same thing with me and, you know, work with girls. So great, great way to find community.
So, yeah. But for someone who was moving around, I guess it would be good. Like you move to a new school and you automatically have a way to kind of meet new people.
Yeah, about half the girls in our troop have been in Japan for quite a while. They're more of that civilian type.
Cool.
But the other half of the girls are, you know, have PCS'd in and out. We have at least one girl this year who is completely brand new to our troop, and she will actually, unfortunately, PCS at the end of the year, so she'll be leaving us as well.
Wow, that's fast.
Yeah,
huh?
Yes, a lot of fluctuation, but it's great because it does, as you said, it gives the girls, you know, kind of a new home to be while they're here, and then gives them that continuity so when they go back to the States, any projects or, you know, patches, awards that they've been working on, they can still continue and finish them.
You know, all of these things, like your kind of patches and awards and things, like these are going to go between places if you moved. It's kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? Not national because it's international, but it's a standardized thing across the board.
Right. The program is the same for all girls in the U.S. And that's actually why Girl Scouts Overseas started, is because if a girl, you know, moved to Japan and, for example, joined the Japanese Girl Scouts, when she then goes on to her next country, for example, if she were in Italy, the Italian program, you know, Italian Girl Guides is completely different from Japanese Girl Scouts, is completely different from, you know, the Girl Guides in the U.K. So this way, she's always doing U.S. Girl Scouts no matter where she is.
I see. Okay, cool. All right, I got it now. I think I am starting to understand.
Awesome.
So do you anything with the Japanese Girl Scouts? Do you guys ever do anything together?
Yes. Like, for example, ski camp we do with the Japanese Girl Scouts, and we go to this ski resort and ski, and we also camp at this giant, I wouldn't say cabin, but it's like
a lodge.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool. Is the language very tough? Do you speak Japanese?
Yeah.
So maybe that's you're a good fit because you can help help interpret a little bit.
A lot of times I am a translator.
Yep.
It is hard though because the nervousness of being in front of the entire
Doki Doki Suru.
Right.
Wakarimashita. All right. So why don't you tell me about why don't you guys give me a little bit of tell people who are listening, if they want to get involved in Girl Scouts and they're not, where do they go to get involved? What do they do?
So the Yokosuka Girl Scouts have a Facebook page, and that's probably the best way to get in touch with them.
Okay.
They also have an email address, which is yokosukagirlscouts@usagso.org. So usagirlscoutsoverseas.org.
Cool. We will put that in the notes for the show.
Thank you so much.
You got it.
And basically, you know, there's a registration fee annually that covers the girls under our insurance policy. And so they would pay the dues and sign up and register and then be placed in a troop. And as you can imagine, you know, the Girl Scouts are always looking for volunteers to be troop leaders. And one of the great things about it is that you don't have to be a parent. You know, I don't have any kids in Girl Scouting. I don't have any daughters or any sons, but I'm still able to be, you know, a volunteer. And you don't have to have any background with it either. A lot of people think, well, I was never a Girl Scout, so I can't get involved. And yeah, that's not the case. You know, we're here sort of open to everybody and wanted to take on, you know, volunteers who are interested in being part of our program and helping girls develop those leadership skills.
So that's a great thing to know, too. I know a lot of military people are always looking for volunteer opportunities. It can help with promotions and things like that. So scouting is a great example. We harped that the Red Cross is a great volunteer example, but scouting is there, too. So Girl Scouts is something to think about for everybody.
Absolutely.
Awesome. All right, Amanda, tell me about this, the Gold Award. What, this is really interesting to me, and I'm curious about it. So tell me about what is it and what does it entail?
So the Gold Award is the highest award you can get as a Girl Scout. And you can only get it in 11th or 12th grade, I believe.
You can get it once you're in high school.
Vicky, why don't you tell me a little bit more about like the kind of big picture perspective of the Gold Award and like what the steps are kind of from beginning to end.
Sure. So the Girl Scout Gold Award is the highest award a girl can earn in Girl Scouting. And what it means is that she's taken a lot of leadership steps to do a project that is sustainable to help her community. So we really encourage girls to think of something that is close to home, something that's passionate for them, and then engage in that project. And they work directly with a community partner. In this example, Amanda has been working with PAWS to build a project that is really based around that community need. The Gold Award requires a minimum of 80 hours of service done by the girl. And there's a quite long application process. So you have to submit an application showing the research you've done to show that there's a community need, you know, why it needs to be here, the people that want it in the community. And then that goes through an approval process that can be quite lengthy. So there's a whole committee that will review the application and either approve it or send it back for some more, you know, a little bit of tweaking.
Right.
And then you actually work on the project. Oftentimes it involves either doing some money earning so you can purchase what you need or getting donations from the community, finding other community partners to help. I know Amanda had some community partners in building her cat partition. And then at the end of the project, once you've done all of your hours and completed everything, then you go back and you submit a final report showing it. You have to show outcomes, right? So that's part of this education piece that we're here to do today is, you know, how many people have been able to learn about this concern.
Interesting. Yeah. Okay, I got it. Cool. So it's really like from beginning to end, like you're submitting a proposal of what you're going to do, why there's a need that you have to do it, then you do it. And then there's kind of an after action portion.
Exactly right. And so all of this is designed to help girls really become leaders, you know, to figure out, you know, if I were going to start my own business, what are those steps that I have to do? What at the end, you know, if you have investors, you have to show your outcomes are working. So this is all really designed to help be a full part of our program for girls.
Man, I love that. That's really, really great. So for your specific project, why don't you tell me about what you did?
For my project, I'm doing cat abandonment awareness. And for my project, I have built a cat partition for paws. I originally was supposed to build a cat wall, but the wall was water damaged, so I built a cat partition instead.
Okay, what is a cat partition? I'm not sure what that is, or maybe explain for anybody listening, what is a cat partition?
A cat partition is like a cat wall, just it's like on a separate wall that's in like the middle of the room. But this one has wheels.
Okay. So what is it, but I'm not sure I know what a cat wall is either. What is it doing?
So a cat wall is like a wall full of shelves that cats can climb on.
Oh, cool. Okay. Got it. It's exactly what you would think it was. That's my fault. Okay, cool. So you built one?
Yeah.
Awesome. What'd you build it out of?
I built it out of wood, and I also like, it's this like glazed looking thing, so it's like protected.
Okay, cool. Where is that gonna, is that for your house? Is that for your cats, or is that gonna be, it's gonna be for paws, you said?
It's currently in paws and is for paws.
So the cat partition is gonna help kind of keep the cats healthy? Like what's kind of the goal of the cat partition at paws? Like what is it gonna accomplish there?
So the cat partition is there so cats that are taken in by paws will be healthy and exercise and stay fit.
Cool. And how did you get interested in this idea? What about this idea about cats and cat abandonment? What drew you to that idea for the community aspect of your gold award?
I went to paws and asked them for a project to do for my gold award, and they said cat abandonment is like a big thing.
Cool. So you knew something with paws, and then they were like, yeah, cat abandonment is the thing we need some help with, and you were like, I got it.
Yeah.
Awesome. That's fantastic. So the next part of this is, and this is something for your gold award, is you need to help educate the community.
Yeah.
Right. So this is pretty fun, and I'm kind of excited to do this because I get to pretend I'm like a radio guy now. It's really cool. So you've collected some questions from people around the community about this, and I'm going to ask you these questions and you're going to answer them. That's the idea, right?
Yeah.
Awesome. So this is stuff that Amanda has collected from around the community about cat abandonment, and she's going to put this information out as part of her gold award for the Girl Scouts. So the first question is from someone named Doshi, and they want to know, why do abandoned cats usually have stubby tails?
So the reason why many cats have stubby tails is because they are, it's a genetic situation for Japanese cats. That means that Japanese cats are also been abandoned, but when you see a long-tailed cat, it also means that American cats are also being abandoned
here
in Japan.
What you're saying is you also see long-tailed cats, which means people are bringing cats over from the United States and they're abandoning them on base.
Yeah, exactly.
Got it. Okay, so from someone named Liz, how do cats become abandoned?
So many cases that, one of the most common case that cats get abandoned is because the family is PCSing and they can't take their cat with them.
And so they just leave the poor little guy?
Yeah.
That's so sad. And I'm assuming paws, once they realize this, someone brings the cat in to paws or...
They try to get as many, like save as many as they can, but there's like so many that are being abandoned or like they're not really found.
They can't keep up.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. The next question here is from Faith. So she has several questions actually, so we'll answer them, one at a time. So how many cats are in the paw shelter right now?
It fluctuates depending on the season.
Okay, cool. And I've been over to paws, so I know the answer to this question, but I'm going to ask it anyway, because, again, this is from Faith. How are the cats treated in the shelter?
They're treated very well. Like, they get fed, they get medicine if they need it, they get their rooms cleaned. Yeah.
All right. And then do people adopt the cats from Paws?
So in many cases, yes, they adopt the cats from Paws, but some cats are unadoptable. And those cats, Paws will take in, spay and neuter them, and then release them back into the wild.
So unadoptable meaning their personality, is they're basically wild, or is that typically what's happening?
Like, they're too wild, they're like
dangerous
to the people. Yeah.
So Travis would like to know, if people adopt abandoned cats, does the shelter help people make them real pets, make them more pet-like?
So they take in the cat and they like try to have them become pets. They need to match the pet with the person. So they'll take in like many people, many families, and see which one's the best fit for the cat, and because for the cat and for the person.
Yeah, they kind of try and fit both sides. That's cool. Perfect. So we're talking about the abandoned cats. Like, what effects, like, kind of circling back to the beginning, right? Like, you leave cats to their own devices and it can become a problem. So what effect do they have on the environment around base and off base and so on?
So they have an effect of, like, because when you abandon them, they're like become hunter mode, and like when they're hungry, they'll go hunt, and they'll eat like mice, little birds, and like little small creatures, and that population will start decreasing.
I see. So they basically become an invasive species at that point, huh?
Yeah.
And they can upset the balance of the whole ecosystem, I suppose. Those small things are. According to the USDA, they can also spread parasites and diseases, damage gardens and property, and are a noise nuisance. Yeah, that sounds bad. I don't want parasites or a noise nuisance. Okay, and your last question here is from Ryan. What resources are there to help if you find an abandoned cat?
So when you find an abandoned cat, there is Paws and other non-kill shelter off base. Like, Paws is a good one for on base. It's one of the only ones on base.
Yep.
And you can contact them and they'll like take in the cat and give them medicine if they need it, get them spayed and neutered if they need it, and food and water and a clean area to live in for a while. If they're again not adoptable, then spayed and neutered them, give them medicine possibly, and put them back into the wild.
So yeah, I think that about wraps it up. I really had fun reading these questions, Amanda. It was a really good time. And Vicky, also, thank you for breaking down Girl Scouts and stuff. I hope anybody who got a chance to listen to this thinks about it as something either to sign up their kids or girls for, or to also as a volunteer experience. So yeah, thank you ladies very much for coming. Vicky, Amanda, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Hope to have you back sometime, and take care, guys.
Thanks. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
The Giant Voice Podcast is a production of Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka Public Affairs Office. The views expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the policy of the Department of the Navy or Department of Defense. Thanks for listening.